1972, a brotherhood of international terrorists challenged the nations of the world in a conflict of murder, assassination, and indiscriminate carnage. The nations of the world responded with a brotherhood of its own, a brotherhood of covert warriors and cops who had made it their mission to make the world no longer safe for terrorists. September 1972, Munich, Germany. Terrorists seize 11 Israeli athletes inside the Olympic Village, demanding the release of Palestinian prisoners held in Israeli jails. Before a worldwide television audience of over 100 million people, German officials negotiated to transport the terrorists and their hostages by helicopter to a nearby military airfield and a waiting jet. A desperate rescue attempt ended in tragedy and failure when the terrorists, under attack, threw grenades into the helicopters and opened fire on the hostages inside. 11 Israeli athletes that Germany vowed to save lay dead. One man who watched the Israeli hostages die in a flurry of chaotic violence vowed that there would be no more Munich massacres. His name was Ulrich Wegener, and his vision was GSG 9.
I told the minister afterwards, I still remember my words, I said, "Sir, this should not happen again. We have to do something." And on the 19th of September, the German federal government decided to establish a special operations unit.
Ulrich Wegener designed and built Grenzschutzgruppe 9, or GSG 9, with only one standard in mind: absolute excellence.
We could not create or establish an ordinary unit like others, you know, the police or the military or whatever. The spectrum of the future mission was so wide, and it should cover all the different terror threats we could envisage. So we decided we have to go very close to to terrorist organizations. You know, we have to do similar things. You know? We have to be more mobile. We have to be more movable and more flexible.
Near Bonn, GSG-9 operators prepare for the call to action. In the smoldering ashes of Munich, the decision was made to create a unique force of federal police officers who could respond to any terrorist attack on German soil or anywhere in the world.
GSG-9 gets an alert call, it takes only 1 hour to be operational for around about 45 men. The spectrum of tasks within GSG-9 is very broad. Basically, everybody in GSG-9 is interchangeable. But within our operational units, we have additional qualifications. For example, our first unit is also a sniper qualified. Our second unit are qualified as combat divers, and they can do maritime tasks. And our third unit is additionally qualified as freefall parachutist, so that they can gain strongholds almost all over the world.
When terrorists strike and lives are on the line, units like the GSG-9 rely on surprise, speed, and cohesive firepower. Constant training is vital to achieve this end.
The more realistic your training is, the more you can guarantee our success. The more realistic the training is, the better for you.
GSG-9 operators perfect their craft in a state-of-the-art training facility modified for the express use of live fire. Video cameras strategically placed throughout the facility monitor and record every facet of an operator's movement.
We are here in the shooting training center of the GSG-9, in which we can realistically imitate and act out all possibilities of missions. In residences, in staircases, in aeroplanes, and even in trains, practicing them. And with the help of video cameras, we can also evaluate them in retrospect in order to discuss mistakes or new tactics and approaches. After we began to film our missions and training, our work became significantly more professional. We can immediately recognize mistakes, stop them, test new strategies, and see where something is lacking, where we can improve something. And that has advanced us significantly.
As a force of last resort, sanctioned to guarantee that there would be no more Munichs, GSG-9 did not have long to wait until called into action. On October 13, 1977, a Lufthansa 737 airliner with 91 passengers and crew on board was hijacked by four terrorists over the Mediterranean. After crisscrossing the Mediterranean and Middle East for some 3 days, the terrorists directed the plane to land in Aden, the capital of Yemen.
And during the stay in Aden, they killed the captain of the aircraft. He was shot right through the head in front of all the passengers. Then, in the meantime, they had took off again, to our surprise, only with a co-pilot in charge of the aircraft. And because of the limited range of the aircraft, they could only go to an African country.
The plane was flown to Mogadishu, Somalia. Unknown to the terrorists, 60 operators from GSG-9, led by their commander, Ulrich Wegner, had followed the hijacked aircraft aboard a specially modified 707. When Flight 181 touched down in Mogadishu, the corpse of the murdered pilot was dumped onto the runway's tarmac. Moments before the terrorists' last deadline to kill all the hostages, the German government ordered GSG-9 into action.
We came from behind so that nobody could see us. In the meantime, I had also given the order to the Somali battalion to seal off the area and to set up a bonfire in front of a sort of distraction. And this worked perfectly. The terrorists saw the fire, they were asking the tower, what's up there? Look at there. And so they were distracted.
At 2:05 a.m., moving silently and swiftly, GSG-9 operators maneuvered the emergency doors to the 737 open.
Police! First assault team hit the leader of the aircraft in the cockpit, and the number two was also hit in the galley. The leader was killed right away, and the number two was severely wounded. We hit the number three man. He was shot right through the head, and the number fourth fired from inside the toilet, and she was killed right away. The whole operation inside the aircraft with the evacuation, 7 minutes. So after 7 minutes, I could report to the government that the work is done.
GSG-9's spectacular rescue assault at Mogadishu was the culmination of years of hard work and training. Awaiting their next call to action, GSG-9 hones its skills to be ready for the next Mogadishu. On a specially built-to-scale model of a plane, team members perfect simultaneous entry techniques. The objective of any hostage rescue assault is always to save lives. When terrorists armed with explosives have the ability to kill hundreds of innocent passengers, decisive firepower is often the last resort. Through perseverance, innovative vision, and unyielding resolve and courage, GSG-9 has forged a global brotherhood of men in arms, dedicated to prove to Germany and to the world that there would be no more Munich massacres. In 1995, terrorists from a Spanish separatist group established a safe house 500 yards from the summer palace of the King of Spain. Spain's King Juan Carlos, aboard the royal yacht off the island of Mallorca, became the target of an assassination plot. From a perch in a top-floor apartment, some 2,000 yards away, the king's movements were monitored through the high-powered scope of a Belgian-produced .308 caliber rifle. When Spanish intelligence services uncovered the unfolding plot, an elite anti-terrorist unit was dispatched to raid the terrorists' flat. The operators were members of Spain's National Counter-Terrorist Unit, the Special Operations Group. They are known simply as the GEO. It is a calling card that terrorists throughout Spain have come to fear.
GEO was created in the year 1978, to be precise, the first day of April in that year. Why was GEO created? Well, we all know that in the 70s, a great wave of terrorism took place all over the world. Governments realized that to stop this specialized type of crime, they had to create specialized policemen with special skills and tools, because the regular police were not trained to handle it.
Consisting of 150 men, this all-volunteer, highly specialized unit from within the National Police Department has garnered the reputation as one of the world's most elite and experienced counter-terrorist and hostage rescue teams.
In Spain, or worldwide, it is said that GEO is one of the units with more experience in the fight against terrorism. This, as I put it, for our own good or bad, is true.
Spain has endured one of the most brutal and hard-fought terrorism campaigns in modern European history. The reputation of the GEO as one of the most operationally experienced units was built on the unpredictable and often deadly atrocities of the Basque Fatherland and Liberty Group, better known as ETA. In their quest for an independent homeland, ETA attacks have targeted government, judicial and security personnel. Waves of incessant attacks have resulted in loss of almost 1,000 lives. This time, the plan to assassinate King Juan Carlos was designed to destroy the nation's weakened sense of security.
It's obvious that in this type of job, one is always exposed to danger. But in the minds of all of us who work here, we never think we will have a negative outcome.
Of course, trust is absolute. There is no time for doubt about the job that needs to be done.
In this type of job, you never work alone, and the trust required in your partners has to be 100%.
If circumstances are so extreme
that I would have to give my life for a partner, I will do it without any hesitation.
All the missions we executed, but in this specific one, due to the special circumstances of the case, His Majesty, the King's life, was at stake, was in danger. So we feel proud, very proud of this mission.
The Spanish pride themselves on the fact that over the course of hundreds of missions, deadly force has been used in only a few operations.
In the interventions or operations that this unit has done, there have only been a few deaths. And this is due to the high level of training we perform. This is focused on averting the loss of lives, if not necessary. We train so that every time we have a mission, the point is to stop the terrorists or organize crime groups without having to shoot at all.
In a remote location in central Spain, GEO operators perfect their skills for the execution of a high-risk hostage rescue mission. In a large-scale training exercise, convicted terrorists have escaped from a local prison. Heavily armed, they have commandeered a prison bus to secure their getaway and have forced an unknown number of prison staff onto the bus as hostages. The terrorists have threatened to execute their hostages if any rescue attempt is made. Before the terrorists reach the main highway, GEO operators plan to launch a tactical assault on the bus.
I believe that it's very clear that if you prepare the scenario where you're going to train as close to reality as possible, you have, by doing things this way, more possibilities to succeed.
Once the bus is neutralized by the operators positioned around the vehicle, they must enter it and secure the passengers. To reduce the risk of terrorists hiding amongst the hostages, everyone aboard the bus is initially suspected as a possible terrorist and transported together to police headquarters. Speed and coordination are key to the successful execution of the mission, as the distraction devices explode to the right side of the bus, diverting the attention of the terrorists. Operators carrying specialized ladders smash the windows of the bus. Once the windows are simultaneously breached, the ladders are lowered, allowing other operators to train their 9mm pistols on the occupants inside the bus. Several operators form a U-shaped perimeter around the vehicle, covering the front, driver's side, and rear, which tactically reduces the chance of crossfire. Without a single shot being fired, it is only a matter of seconds before every potential terrorist on the bus is caught in the crosshairs of a GEO operator.
Please don't storm the building. If you storm the building, they'll start shooting and killing, because we were convinced that they will do that. Every one of them is fully armed. Not only machine guns or various other guns, also hand grenades. So it was pretty serious stuff.
April 30th, 1980. Six armed terrorists opposed to the revolutionary rule of Ayatollah Khomeini approached the Iranian embassy in London, located at 16 Prince's Gate. Inside the embassy was BBC sound technician Sim Harris.
We'd gone to get a visa to go back and work in Iran, where was, you know, the Americans were being held hostage. We were waiting in the lobby to see a guy called Dr. Izzati, who was a press attaché. And suddenly, through the door came a bunch of guys with grenades and guns, and that was the start of it all.
The terrorists were Iranian Arabs, who demanded autonomy for their people and the release of 92 Arab prisoners held in Iranian jails. If the government of Iran refused their demands, the terrorists vowed to blow up the embassy and kill all 26 hostages.
They managed to get a phone call with the then foreign minister in Iran, who told them quite blatantly on the phone, "You can never dream of achieving your demands. And we consider all the hostages in the Iranian embassy as martyrs."
As the world watched and waited, the lead terrorist, calling himself Ohm, began a lengthy negotiation with the authorities for a broadcast of their demands.
Since I was the only Arab speaker hostage, in view of the fact that none of them spoke English, unfortunately, I was put in a position to negotiate on their behalf with the security outside through various windows of the embassy. Often I would be on the window, behind me one or two gunmen with their guns pointed at my head or at my back, telling me what to tell the police outside. And the security outside started to bargain with them. "Okay, we will broadcast the statement if you release a hostage." Eventually, they released the hostage. It was approaching 9 o'clock. The agreement was with the police outside that 9 o'clock it would be put on air. And everybody was sort of hostages, terrorists. All of us were very, very tense. It was a very serious situation because they did seriously threaten to start shooting hostages if the broadcast did not go on air.
"The reason for us to come to Britain to carry out this operation..."
That moment, the whole atmosphere in the embassy, in the room, changed. Everybody was hugging everybody, tears in our eyes, dancing, kissing each other, gunmen kissing hostages, hostages hugging terrorists.
It was quite an amazing scene of emotion, people crying with relief, and then food came in, and it was like a sort of a party atmosphere.
It was a relief for everybody that at least the shooting will not start, or we're preventing the shooting at least at this moment.
As the siege dragged on to the fifth day, Mustafa Karkuti became seriously ill.
I was really in bad situation. Then Aoun, the leader, came to me and said, "Well, look, we are sorry that we caused all this trouble for you. We have decided to let you go." This link, which I was playing during the siege, would go away. Nobody can fill because of the culture, the language, and of course, the relation I managed to build with the terrorist and also the other hostages and the security outside. But physically, mentally, I was not. I was not capable of. Go, go.
he had been a great peacemaker and a great sort of go-between. But anyway, he went, and that was it. It then sort of went from bad to worse. They lost discipline. They became frustrated. You know, they started arguing amongst themselves. I got the impression that, you know, that the sort of lower ranks were saying to one, hang on a minute, you told us this was all going to be over in a few days, and here we are, we haven't got hardly any concessions. They're making monkeys of us. You know, we've got to show a bit of strength now.
The turning point in the siege was marked by the disposal of the body of an executed hostage. As the horrific image was televised to the outside world, the terrorists threatened to execute a hostage every 30 minutes.
A body was thrown out, and the security people went to the entrance door. They carried the body on a stretcher. The body was wearing a yellow jumper. I immediately realized who it was. It was Abbas Lavazani, the cultural attaché. I told my wife immediately, that's Lavazani. Now they are going to storm the building.
Hearing the gunshots and then someone telling you that they had killed him. What had been what I thought was a student publicity stunt, suddenly just all changed. You know, it was all too real.
It rapidly became clear on the sixth day that we would have to resort to sending in the SAS. The SAS are there as a means of dealing with things that are beyond the capabilities of the Metropolitan Police or the other police force that are there. And we know that if we deal with the SAS and ask them to do something that we think is impossible, they will try and do it.
The reputation of the Special Air Service, initially formed to execute commando raids during World War II, is legendary. The remarkable success of the unit was exemplified by their motto, "Who dares wins." By 1980, the 22nd SAS Regiment was Britain's unrivaled response to terror. The SAS plan called for multiple assault teams to enter from the front, roof, and rear of the embassy. By entering each floor of the embassy simultaneously, they hoped to reach the hostages before they could be executed. Seconds before the start of Operation Nimrod, negotiators seemingly agreed to the terrorists' demand of safe passage to the Middle East.
Police were on the end of the phone and they were saying, right, sir, you're all going to be flown out. And we just want to talk to the leader about the arrangements. They started going into enormous detail. All the other hostages were up in the telex room right at the top of the building. And I thought, wow, you know, this is it. Thank God for that. We're all going to get out of here. And then just all hell broke loose. The girls started screaming. And I turned around and I saw a door. And I, frankly, you know, I just wanted to get out. I went in and saw some chinks of light. And I pulled the shutters and the curtains open. And there was this guy standing there, all dressed in black with balaclavas and helmets and hoods and machine guns and pistols and gas masks. And he just said, get down, get down. Knelt on the floor to the side of the window behind a wall. There was this almighty explosion and the window just blew apart. And the four guys came through, you know, all dressed like, almost like frogmen almost. And through the mask, they were saying, stay there, don't move.
Throwing stun grenades into the breach, the four-man assault team disappeared into the embassy. In the telex room on the second floor, terrorists open fire on several hostages, killing one and seriously wounding another, before the SAS raced in to free the hostages. As fires broke out in the embassy filled with smoke and tear gas, Sim Harris attempted to flee the embassy.
I crawled out onto the balcony, and all I could hear from below me, I was on the first floor, was, "That's Harris, that's Harris, stay down." I kept screaming, "Stay down." At one point, it was getting so bad, the heat behind me and cinders dropping from above as well, I thought, I'm gonna have to jump. They suddenly said, "Go to your left, go to your left." First of all, I thought it was madness to go back in the embassy again. But then, you know, these guys are screaming at me. And the SAS guy was calling me through. And, you know, he just shoved me across. And I remember treading on a body or two as I went through the room. I didn't know whether they were terrorists, hostages, or whatever. Went back into this central stairway. And they just got hold of us like rag dolls. I mean, it was just like rag dolls. They were just screaming, "Get out, get out," and throwing us down and out onto the lawn at the back. And then they just threw us on the ground, put a knee in our back and put straps around our hands. And that was it, you know. We were a threat and we had to be tied up. And then I was lying there thinking, this is just like a movie. I mean, this is just amazing. I mean, tied up with these tie straps on me. And one of the terrorists is lying on the ground tied up as well.
Of the six terrorists, the sole survivor was quickly identified and separated from the hostages. Remarkably, all but one hostage was rescued by the spectacular and daring skill of the SAS.
We did a very courageous operation, which was very, very successful. And I think on that day they struck a real blow for democracy, against terrorism, and I'm sure people in Britain are forever grateful to them for what they did.
I think it was a hugely dangerous thing to undertake. You know, there's sufficient information come out of the embassy to say in there's almost certainly six terrorists who are heavily armed with, you know, nearly as good a weapons as you've got. Will you please go inside and rescue as many hostages as you possibly can, ideally all of them, unharmed? Now, to undertake that, I think requires a huge amount of bravery and certainly a knowledge that you're putting your own life on the line. They're not madmen, but thank God we've got people as skilled as that and as controlled as that to do this type of thing in the name of law and order.
Few nations on Earth possess the massive military might that the United States can field. It can send more troops farther in the world and faster than any other nation on Earth.
Special operations forces like the 75th Ranger Regiment can deploy anywhere in the world within 11 hours.
They are the best of the best in the U.S. Army's order of battle. They are used as a support force designed to back up the military formation that is summoned when hostages are taken and America's national security put to the test. In 1989, the administration of George Bush was focused on the deteriorating situation in Panama. Widespread demonstrations calling for the removal of General Manuel Noriega were violently crushed. But Noriega, reportedly involved in drug trafficking and corruption, refused to step aside. The United States decided to intervene. The entire Ranger Regiment was tasked to spearhead the invasion of Panama, codenamed Operation Just Cause.
By October 1989, these American Special Operations Forces were conducting intensive training exercises. A primary objective of Operation Just Cause was the capture of General Noriega. The mission was assigned not to the Rangers, but the U.S. Army's most elite Special Operations Unit. Selected for their highly developed and specialized skills, this secretive unit is the United States Army's elite counter-terrorist team. In addition to the capture of General Noriega, special operators were tasked with the rescue of an American businessman arrested by Noriega for operating an underground radio station. Kurt Muse, accused of being a CIA operative, was into his ninth month of solitary confinement.
I was in Modelo Prison, which was across the street from Noriega's headquarters building. My prison was built in the 1920s, originally designed to house 250 prisoners. When I was there, it had well in excess of 1,000. I had food given to me once a day. I slept on the ground, and I had a stinky little form of a man. And that was my home for 9 months.
General Noriega, refusing pressure from the United States to resign, issued a direct threat to every American in Panama.
If there was an invasion of any sort, he would take reprisals against U.S. citizens in Panama, which were many, and he would begin by executing Kurt Muse. So from that day forward, I had an executioner posted at my door with a gun. And his only orders were to shoot me if anyone attempted to rescue me.
For this reason, the top secret rescue of Kurt Muse, codenamed Operation Acid Gambit, was to commence moments prior to the launch of Operation Just Cause.
December 20th, in the evening, I go to my window, look across the street. Noriega's headquarters building is blacked out. Sandbags everywhere. My guards in my prison all have their little bandoliers. They have extra ammunition. Everybody's loaded for bear. Everybody knows that something's gonna happen soon. All hell breaks loose across the street. Everything you can imagine is hitting that comandancia, the headquarters building. I hear explosions. I hear people running around. Shot, explosions. And then the hall starts filling with a thick, acrid, white smoke. And it starts drifting into the prison. I see these little lights, little white lights. And out of this smoke, a guy, saw an apparition, comes to the door. He says, "Moose, are you okay?" I go, "Yeah, I'm okay." He says, "Get down, I'm blowing the door." Close the door, and this guy comes running in, gets on his knees, and he puts his hands on me. He says, "Moose, we're gonna take you home."
As Spectre gunships attacked Noriega's headquarters complex, Muse and his rescue force of six operators made their way to the prison's rooftop and awaiting helicopter.
All hell's breaking loose. There's bullets, tracers, just every which way. The helicopter takes off and we're taking fire. Heavy fire. Peels off. And we just, as we're falling to the ground, just missed the wall of the prison, away from the major fighting. And the chopper lands quite heavily in the road. And we go up the street, bumping on our skids. And the chopper takes off again. As we get to about the second or third story high, we're shot down for real this time.
All aboard the chopper, except for Muse, were wounded by gunfire or injured in the crash.
We managed to help one another up, and we hid out in the bottom of an apartment building while the rest of the commandos set up a perimeter defense. Many of these folks were very, very badly wounded. Yet in spite of all these wounds, they behaved with a precision, with a forethought, with a plan that was very impressive. It was just incredible.
A passing Black Hawk helicopter spotted an infrared signal from one of the operators. An armored personnel carrier from the 6th Infantry Division arrived and extracted Kurt Muse and his rescue team.
My rescue seemed like it took 15, 20, 30 minutes. 6 minutes. That means landing, fighting your way down two stories of a locked prison, rescuing me, bringing me back, and being airborne. 6 minutes.
To rescue American hostage Kurt Muse from Panama, an elite special operations unit from the U.S. Army devised an insertion and extraction plan. They rehearsed repeatedly on a full-scale plywood replica of Modella Prison in a remote location of the United States.
How's that feel for your head motion? Feels good? Yeah, feels good. Great, thank you very much.
For the first time ever, miniature cameras secured to America's most elite commandos will provide a first-hand glimpse into how one of the world's most secretive counter-terrorist units operates.
Second Battalion, 1st Special Warfare Training Group. We just witnessed a four-man assault element going into an urban environment and going through room clearing. If you watch the news at all, you understand that today's modern battlefield is no longer operating in the woods, and it's operating in an urban environment. So people teaching us, other special operations members, tactics in an urban environment is paramount for success. On Sergeant Back, you notice he's got flashbangs, flashbang pouch on the back. They are there for the man behind him to grab him. We use flashbangs to stun possibly whoever may be in the next room and regain some momentum. It's a little surprise. He's armed with a Remington 870 shotgun, radio, 5.56 magazines. On this side, he's got a place for his strobe light, more magazines, secondary weapon, M9 Beretta pistol, and then primary weapon, M4 carbine, which is a 5.56 or a 223 caliber.
As you know, these are the elite of the elite. And I am the most grateful citizen in the world to these people for doing what they did. But I find, almost to a man, they say, "But sir, we were just doing our duty."